So the topic of this talk is really complementary to the one that we heard in the morning. There are some nice intersections between these two approaches, and I will try to point them out as we go. And just like in the morning, if anybody has any question during the talk, please raise your hand and wave if I don't see you, and I will repeat the question. And it's better to get these things out of the way, especially if it's about notation and that sort of stuff. Okay, so let me start with a little bit of introduction just to explain why verification of machine learning can be useful. The very obvious thing, software systems are really everywhere these days, right? When you look at phones, airplanes, hospital, everywhere you look, there is software. And the complexity of the software is really increasing, right? If you keep in mind something like autonomous driving, we're expecting this software to do really, really complicated tasks. And it turns out that manually creating this software is a very difficult thing. Right? This is a challenge that humanity has been struggling with ever since programming was invented. We can't seem to get programming straight, right? Our software tends to have bugs and issues. So in recent years, we've been seeing this trend where people are resorting to machine learning. Right? So you start with a very complicated set of requirements that you need to satisfy. So again, think about autonomous driving. Then you somehow extract, so creating software that satisfies these requirements manually is too difficult. So you somehow extract examples of how the system should behave. You give these examples to a machine learning algorithm, and you get back an artifact, right? This black box that satisfies the requirements, or sort of satisfies the requirements. And this kind of programming has proven to be remarkably useful for many tasks like image recognition, game playing, right? We mentioned AlphaGo this morning, and autonomous driving. So really, we're accomplishing things that are very difficult to accomplish manually. So this is quite a remarkable thing. And while these black box artifacts, the nature of these black box artifacts is really useful for us, right? Because it really allows non-experts to use this kind of technology. You can go on Coursera, take a short course, and you know how to produce these black box artifacts. But this also raises some interesting questions, right? Because we don't really understand what's going on inside these black boxes. They're opaque. We don't understand how they make the decisions that they make. And it turns out that traditional things that we do for quality assurance really don't apply to these black boxes, right? If you think about things that are best practices for traditional code, things like code reviews, refactoring, writing invariants, comments, all of these things do not really apply to artifacts generated using machine learning. And the question is, how do we know what's going on inside the black box? How do we gain some confidence that it is behaving as it should? So you could say, well, we are confident that no bad things will happen. So I have a convincing little video. It's very short. So this is about a Tesla. Right? There's a Tesla Model S in autopilot mode. And the video is from the point of view of a car that's driving behind the Tesla. It's from a dash camera. And in a second, please pay attention to the left-hand side of the road. Okay, so this video is from a couple of years ago already, and if you noticed, the left shoulder of the road was getting narrower and narrower because of some road work that was going on, and the Tesla didn't figure this out, and it bumped into the yellow obstacle. And of course, this was a pretty mild thing. There were no casualties, but there have also been fatal accidents involving autonomous vehicles already, one from a few months ago. And so I hope this is sufficient motivation that we really care about what's going on inside these black boxes, because these things are going to be on our cars probably in a few years. So another example of a system that's maybe more immediate is the ACAS-XU system. All right, so ACAS stands for Airborne Collision Avoidance System, and XU means it's for unmanned aircraft, it's for drones. This is a system that's currently being developed by the American FAA, the Federal Aviation Administration. That's the body that's in charge of regulating air traffic, I guess, aviation in the US. And the ACAS-XU system is a system that's meant to be mounted on an airborne drone. Right? So this is the on-chip. In their terminology, the on-chip is us. Right? So the system sits on an actual drone that's airborne, and it reads sensor information about another drone that's nearby. That's the intruder. And it reads information like speeds, distances, angles, so a little bit of information that you get through sensors. And then the system needs to make an advisory. So an advisory is just a suggestion to the operator of the drone about what they should do in order to prevent a collision. So there are only five possible advisories. First one is clear of conflict. It says you can keep on flying on the trajectory that you're currently on. It's fine. And the other four are turning advisories. You can get an advisory for making a strong turn to the left, a weak turn to the left, or a strong right, or a weak right. So intuitively, the idea is that if the operator were to follow these instructions, then there would be no collision. So it turns out that the logic of this, so initially they tried to implement this system manually, as same as you would do for traditional software, and it turned out that the logic was a little too complex for manual implementation. They couldn't get all the corner cases correct. So afterwards, they switched to another approach. They had a very large lookup table. Right, so this lookup table just had many, many rows, and in every row there was one possible sensor reading. And the way the system worked was that you would read sensor information, you would go to that row of the table, and you would do what the advisory was written there. So this was just a big lookup table. And if the sensor reading didn't hit a particular cell in the table, then you would do some interpolation. Right? You would find the nearest neighbors, and you would do some average or whatever. And there, the problem was that the table was just too large. It was 2 gigabytes, which was apparently too large for the hardware that it was intended to run on this small unmanned aircraft. And then the FAA actually switched, or still considering switching, and it's still an open question of whether or not they will do it. They switched to this, looked into this approach that uses neural networks. So the motivation was compression, right? They trained a neural network to do what the table did previously, to take the sensor information and produce an advisory. And it turned out that with a neural network, you gained significant compression, right? The space required was significantly reduced to just 3 megabytes. And also, the neural networks actually did better than the table in some senses, because the interpolation was much smoother. Right? They knew how to handle better the cases that didn't fall specifically on the entries of the table. And of course, this kind of thing requires a new certification procedure. Right? It's a new kind of system that they are still debating on whether they can use. And an important part of their decision will be whether they can certify this system in a satisfactory manner. Right? They know how to work with lookup tables. Neural networks are new. Right? So especially because this is a new approach, they really want to be rigorous in certifying it. Yeah?
Sorry, but can you explain why the logic approach didn't work?
The first one, the
That's
manual?
Obvious,
so what I understood was that it turned out it didn't take much code, right? It was a pretty simple program, but the corner cases, right? So all those extreme cases where you need to choose between a couple of possible advisories, these were very, very difficult to handle correctly. So they have some criteria for correctness, and I think they were able to reach about 98% correctness manually. But of course, for such a safety critical system, they want, you know, as close to 100% as possible. Yeah?
Similar question. How came these 2 gigabytes as a table? And does the table contain all the corner cases?
Okay, so I just remembered I need to repeat the question. So how did they come up with the table, and does the table contain the corner cases? So I think there's a very large database of recorded cases from history, of data that was collected, and this was used to train the table using Markov decision processes. Okay. Okay, so this was another example for a system, a safety critical system where people are really considering using neural networks, right? So again, it's very, very important to be able to certify these systems to understand what's going on inside the black boxes. So what are they doing now, right? How did they want to certify the system? So the traditional thing that you do is testing and simulation, right? This is the standard practice. And what they do is they generate these encounter plots. Right, so in this plot, you see the on-chip is in the center. It's a little dark, so it's hard to see. And several of the input parameters have been fixed. So this is just one example. And this figure shows you the expected advisory based on the location of the intruder. Right, so the intruder is up there on the right upper corner. So if the intruder is in the region that's marked white, that's the clear of conflict region. Right? So if the intruder is very far away or has already passed us, then we expect a clear of conflict advisory. But if the intruder is coming at us from the left, then we are maybe in the weak right, the WR region. Then if the other guy is coming from the left, we want the advisory to be that we should turn right, and et cetera. So I think this is pretty self-explanatory. And this one is a pretty easy encounter plot. There are some that look really crazy if they change some of the parameters. So one thing that you can do is generate these encounter plots, and then you can look at them and see that everything is OK. Right? But of course, these plots are generated using a finite sampling. Right? They simulate a finite number of inputs, and they run them through the network, and they see what advisory that they get. But there are no guarantees, for instance, that inside the weak right region, there are no strong left points hiding, right? And we just didn't sample them. So the problem is, again, this thing with covering an infinite number of points, right? And this is where verification can maybe help. Yeah. So the question is, does this apply also to the table case or just to the neural network? So this is what they were producing these encounter plots also for the table. But for the table, they know, I mean, it's a more commonly used technique. They are not afraid of some unexplained behavior. Maybe they should be, I don't know. Mainly because this is a new thing, these neural networks, and they say, we don't really understand what's going on inside, right? There could be some catastrophic failure that we simply haven't sampled, and so they really want to be sure. Okay, so what is verification? So in one slide, just to make sure we're all on the same page. So the more general setting of verification is that you are given some program P and some property phi, and you ask, does P satisfy phi? Okay, so pretty straightforward. And there are two possible outcomes. One is that you prove that your program satisfies your property, or the other that you find a counterexample showing that it doesn't satisfy your property. Okay, so this is verification in the broad sense. And of course, this really gives you stronger guarantees than testing, right? You ask for every possible input, does the property hold, not just for a finite set that you can sample. But computationally, it is much more expensive, right? It is undecidable in the general case, and even when it is decidable, it is very difficult computationally to do. So there's been a lot of work on verifying traditional systems. By traditional, I mean a manually created software. So we know how to handle various software constructs, like loops, conditions, a bunch of stuff. We know also what properties we need to check. Right? For example, we always want to have no array overflows. We want to not divide by zero, et cetera, et cetera. There are many things that we know that we should look for. And there's also been a lot of work on improving scalability. Right? We know there's been decades of work on verifying larger and larger systems. But all of these things, we now need to figure out for machine learning generated software. Right? We need to understand how to verify, what to verify, and how to improve our scalability. And is it even worth the effort? Well, I think that the answer is yes. I will try to convince you. And especially when it comes to safety critical systems like AKS-XU, where it's really worth it to put in the effort because you have a lot to lose. Right? It's a very safety critical system. So another example where verification can really be useful, so this is a very hot topic right now, adversarial inputs. And I know maybe somebody else already talked about it in one of the earlier days of the workshop, of the summer school. So a few years ago, people observed this interesting property where neural networks were apparently very easy to fool. Right? So they took a state-of-the-art neural network for image recognition. So neural networks are one kind of these black box artifacts that I mentioned. And they took a state-of-the-art network and they gave it a picture on the left. And the network was able to say, this is a panda. And so these networks also say with what confidence they say what they say. So the network said with 57.7% confidence, this is a panda. And then they added some very small amount of noise and they got another picture. Right? To the human eye, it looks identical. It's still clearly a panda. But now the neural network says that this is a gibbon, right? Which is a completely different animal with 99% confidence. Right, so this is pretty alarming, right? Because it really means that the network is not does not really understand what a panda is, right? It's very easy to fool. And since then, it's been observed that these small perturbations can lead to whole kinds of problems in practically every state-of-the-art network out there. And finding these inputs is not even difficult. Right? You can find these noises that you need to add very, very quickly. There are very quick techniques that can come up with the noise, and it's very easy to fool neural networks. It turns out matters are even worse. Right? It's not just that you can fool networks, but you can really fool a network to a specific target. Right? So it's not just that you give me a panda and I will find some noise that will cause misclassification, but rather you tell me, misclassify this panda into a cat, and I will be able to find the noise that you need to add. Right, so it's a pretty extensive thing. And people have also showed that you can carry out these attacks in the real world. People have printed out images with some small perturbations, and the real systems that use neural networks to identify this system, these pictures have misclassified them. Right, so this is pretty alarming. For instance, Again, maybe in the context of an autonomous vehicle that uses a neural network for recognizing traffic signs, right? You can maybe be concerned about natural malformation of the input. Maybe some traffic signs have, you know, the weather have worn them out, or they changed their angle or something. And also there is the possibility of somebody doing malicious things, right? Maybe somebody can come and you know, alter a stop sign and make it be recognized as a entering highway sign. Yeah.
So what kind of knowledge do I need to know about the algorithm to attack it?
Okay, so the question is, how do you attack neural networks, right? What do you need to know in order to do this? So obviously, if you have access to the neural network, like to all its parameters and topology, then you can do this pretty easily. But there's also been a lot of work on transferability, where people train without having access to the neural network that they are trying to attack. They train a different kind of network that is similar to the one that they are trying to attack. Then they attack this network to which they have access, and these attacks also fool the original in many cases. It's a really very active field of research. People are doing a lot of crazy things. Okay? So this phenomenon is called adversarial inputs. And the other side of the coin is adversarial robustness. Okay, so adversarial robustness measures a network's resilience to these adversarial attacks. There exist many techniques for increasing robustness. Right? So people are coming up with attacks against neural networks, and they're also coming up with defenses to increase robustness. But these typically defend against existing attacks. So what happens is that, you know, today we know 10 different attacks, and somebody comes with a new kind of defense. And they say, well, my defense now beats all existing attacks. My network is robust. But then tomorrow somebody comes with a new attack, which breaks your old defense, right? So this arm cycle continues. And what you can do with verification is you can establish guarantees, right? You can come up with guarantees that that we know that will hold even for tomorrow's attack, right? You can really prove that the network is robust, not just against the attacks that you are familiar with. Okay, so this is another place where verification can really be helpful. And again, this is important for safety critical systems. So hopefully I've convinced you that you know, software is everywhere and people are using machine learning to write this software now. And there, some problems with these systems have already been observed, right? So this is not some theoretical thing. We know that there are problems. And certification of these systems is a new and very significant challenge. And there's a lot of interest from industry on how we think certification should happen. And in the next parts of the presentation, I will focus on these neural networks. So you could ask these questions also about other kinds of machine learning generated software, but I'll be talking on neural networks. And I will show you why the verification of neural networks is a hard problem. Then I will survey what people have been up to. This has been a very active field of research in the last few years, and I will show you what people have been attempting. Then in the last part, I will discuss one of these techniques called ReluPlex, in which I was involved in more detail. Okay, so a quick introduction to neural networks. Again, just to make sure that we are all on the same page. So this is a neural network, right? It has the first layer is the input layer, the last layer is the output layer. Those in between are the hidden layers. And the way that you evaluate a neural network is you have values for one layer, which you then use in some mathematical computation to evaluate the next layer and the next layer, all the way to the output layer. So the typical sizes of these networks are somewhere between a few hundreds to millions. Okay, and when I say sizes, I mean the number of neurons. So there are different measures. Some people care about the number of edges, right? But when I say, for the purpose of this talk, when I talk about size, I mean the number of neurons. So So the first layer is the input layer. So in the ACAS XU example, this can be the sensor readings. Right? These are the values that come from the sensors, which we feed to the neural network. Then the output is the scores for the possible advisories. Right? We had five possible scores, so five possible advisories. So they each get a score, and the one with the highest score wins. And all the others are hidden. Now, and of course, every edge has a weight that is assigned to it, and this defines the behavior of the network. I assume everybody is familiar with this, so I'm very quickly going over these terms. So these neural networks are created by training, right? This is when you train the network typically on a finite set of inputs, and then you expect it to generalize also to inputs that it has not seen before. And training is about picking good weights, right? This is what the machine learning algorithms do. If the network behaves incorrectly, then they adjust the weights to correct this behavior. And this is really not the scope of my talk. We just assume for the purpose of verification that the network has already been trained. Right? We assume that we get it with the weights, the topology has already been determined, and we just want to verify certain properties. So the nodes, the neurons of the neural network are evaluated layer by layer. Right? So one, the first layer is given, and then afterwards, each layer is computed from its predecessor using two steps. First, we do weighted sums, and then we applied activation functions. So if we look at one transition, right, so imagine that this is one part of a much larger neural network, then the edges have weights W1, W2, and W3. And then the value for the node V4 is computed from the nodes that came before it using according to the weights. Right, so we just do a weighted sum. It's pretty straightforward. And then comes the activation function. So this is this function F that is applied to the weighted sum. And the result of F becomes the value for V4. So what kind of activation functions are there? So the most, probably the simplest one is called a ReLU, a rectified linear unit. It just takes the ReLU of X is just the max between 0 and X. So in other words, if X is positive, it stays. If it's negative, it becomes a 0. So if X is positive, or rather non-negative, we say that the ReLU is in its active phase, okay? In which case the output is X. So for example, if this is the input, then the weighted sum that you get gives you 1. And then the value for the next node is just 1. Right? It's positive, so it stays. This is the active case. But you have the inactive phase, in which case, if the weighted sum gives you a negative number, then you change it into a 0. Right? So again, it's pretty straightforward. If the weighted sum is negative, then the output is 0. So this is one particular function that I'll be talking quite a lot about. But there are also a few others, which I will briefly mention. So there are pooling layers. So people set the activation function to be max pooling, which just returns the maximal value from its inputs. And so this is a way to look at several neurons and just pick the largest one. There's also average pooling, which just does the same with average instead of max. And there are also non-piecewise linear functions, like the sigmoid functions and the hyperbolic tangent function, which are just these S-shaped things, which I'm not going to talk about. So what does it mean to verify these neural networks? So this is a pretty simplified definition. So for a neural network N that maps input X to output Y, we have some input property P and some output property Q. And we want to know, does there exist an input for which the input property holds, but the output property does not hold? OK? Now this, so in verification, what you typically do is you want to verify, you check the negation of what you care about. Right, so P will just characterize the inputs that we want to look at. So for example, if you think about the AKSXU network and you want to check that for intruders that are very far away, the advisory is clear of conflict, then P of X will characterize the intruders that are far away. Right, it will say that we care about intruders that are very distant. Whereas Q will characterize the undesired behavior for these inputs. Right? So I'm here, I'm casting the verification problem as a satisfiability problem. Right? If you want to show that the advisory is always clear of conflict, then the Q that you will test for is that the advisory is not clear of conflict. Right? Because you're looking for an input that violates the property that you care about. So if we get a negative answer, which in satisfiability terminology is called ansat, then this means that the property holds. Right? If the question is, for every distant intruder, the advisory is not clear of conflict, and we get unsat, then this means that we are happy. But if you get a sat answer, then you get a counterexample. Right? You get a particular input that violates the output that you care about. Yeah?
So the property is
OK, so the question is, if I understand correctly, can the output depend on the input in the properties that you're...
The evaluation of the quality of the output depends on the input.
OK, so when you select these properties, you define them in a way. So P restricts the inputs that you care about to a specific region in the input space. And Q is the property that is desirable for those particular inputs. Right, so for example, you would ask, for a distant intruder, is the advisory always clear of conflict? This is the desired behavior for intruders that are far away, but not for intruders that are nearby. Right, so use P to characterize the inputs for which the property should hold. And of course, this is a very simplified definition because I didn't say what is n, how it's given, right, and how do you define p and q. But this is just to give you a general taste. Okay, so this is, I think, the example that I just mentioned. So if the intruder is distant, the network always answers clue of conflict. Right, so our input property would be maybe that the first, so the inputs are vectors, right? So maybe that the first entry of the input vector, which represents the distance to the intruder, is greater than some constant. And the output property would be a disjunction. So suppose y0, right, the first index of y is the clear of conflict score. So if we are checking the negation, we would ask whether it's possible that either one of the other advisories gets a higher score. Right, so we're asking, is it possible that the weak right or strong right or weak left or strong left, either one of them got a higher score than our clear of conflict. And again, unsat means that the system behaves well, whereas sat would give us the counterexample. Adversarial robustness, right? So we talked about this way to measure how robust a network is to adversarial examples. So here we want to ensure that for a given input x0, which represents our panda, right, and a given amount of noise delta, the classification remains the same. This also we can cast into a verification problem. Right, so here the input property would focus us on the inputs that are close to x0. Right, so we're looking at x whose distance from x0 is at most delta, according to some distance matrix. And this, of course, is equivalent to just a big conjunction where you ask, so here I use the L infinity distance matrix, which just means that these two inputs are at most delta apart on each of their coordinates. Right, so this is just a big conjunction. And the output property would be just as before. We are checking whether one of the other outputs, which is not the panda, right, so one of the other labels, gets a higher score. Okay, so as before, unsat means that the property holds, whereas sat means that it doesn't. Right, so this is how you can really cast many interesting questions into verification questions. Yeah. Sorry, can you repeat? So the question is, what about adversarial examples that, if I understand correctly, are unlikely in the real world?
Yeah.
So so right now, the way that I wrote this this property, we're checking for any kind of input that is nearby to x0, right, to our panda, in which case we can maybe get examples that are unlikely in the real world. If you know how to characterize the examples that you care about, then you can also add these constraints to P. Right, you can say, I don't just want an x that is close to x0, but rather you can say, I want x that is close to x0 and for which all the pixels are within some certain range that I think is likely. You can also add these constraints in. Okay? Yeah. Yeah, go ahead.
But you couldn't condition q on the fact that x0 is arbitrary and has
So the question is, can we condition Q on the high confidence of X?
X0.
So I will talk more about that later on. So hold that thought. Yeah.
So I want to have some clarification. So unsat means that if there does not exist
the X0 and the Y0 such that both XP, X0 and the Q, Y0 holds true. Yeah, so the question is about, why unsat means that, let me just repeat the explanation again. So, here these bars don't mean not, they just mean vectors, right? So there's no negation hidden there. So P is the inputs that we care about, right? It characterizes the inputs that we are interested in. And Q always represents the negation of the property that we want. Right, so if we want the network to be robust, we want everything around x0 to be classified as a panda. So q says that the classification is not a panda. Right, so q is the only thing that has a negation in it. So if you're able to find a satisfying assignment, that means that you found an input that is nearby x0, which is what you want, and for which the output is not a panda. Right, so this indicates a bad behavior of the network. So in verification, what you typically do is you negate the property that you want to prove, right? Because if I wrote that Q is that the output is classified as a panda, right? If I didn't negate it, then I would just get one input that is classified. I would get something that's really close to X0 and is classified as a panda. But this would not prove that there are no other points nearby that are not classified as a panda. So by negating the property, right, we are getting a response that says that there, for every x0 in this region, it cannot be that x is not classified as a panda. Right, this is the only way that guarantees that this property will hold. Okay, I hope this makes sense. Okay, so how complex is this problem? So it turns out that even for very simple neural networks, right, so for networks that just have the ReLU activation functions, and for properties P and Q that are just conjunctions of linear constraints, so everything is pretty simple, the problem is already NP-complete. It's NP-complete in the size of the number of ReLU constraints that you have. So I will briefly show you this the proof, just because it has some interesting insights about why the problem is difficult. Right? So what makes a problem NP-complete? So it needs to be in NP, and it needs to be NP-hard. Right? So membership in NP is very simple. If somebody gives you a satisfying assignment, you just run it through the network, you evaluate the network, and you see that it satisfies P and Q. Right? So membership in NP is easy. And next, I will show you a reduction that shows that the problem is NP-hard. So the reduction is from the three SAT problem. So the input, just to remind everyone, you have these n Boolean variables, x1 to xn. The input is just a formula that has k clauses, where every clause is a disjunction between three literals, where every literal is either a variable or its negation. Right? So you just have this little Boolean formula. And the question is, does there exist a satisfying assignment? Right? So you assign the Boolean variables to true or false, in a way that satisfies the formula, the conjunction of the clauses. And the reduction will be taking this problem and turning it into a verification problem, such that the verification problem is satisfiable if and only if the formula is satisfiable. Okay, so I'm going to start with a formula and show you how to construct a neural network that will be satisfiable if and only if the original formula is satisfiable. So the first thing that we want to do is to handle negations, right? Because we have these literals that are either variables or their negations. So if you have some variable xj, and assume for now that it's only 0 or 1, right? There are only two possible values, then computing its negation is very simple. You just compute 1 minus x, right? So if x was 1 that signifies true, right? Then 1 minus 1 will give you 0, which is false, which is the negation of true, and vice versa if it was 0. Right? So this is pretty standard. So computing the negation of things is very easy in neural networks. Disjunctions are a little more tricky. So if you have three literals, Q1, Q2, and Q3, and you want to compute the disjunction, then you would add this TI node that has the ReLU activation function applied to it. And now if you look, if at least one of the inputs is 1, right, say Q1 is 1, right, it's true. If at least one of them is 1, then TI, the weighted sum will be negative. Right? It will be minus 1 or lower. Plus 1, right, we add the constant 1 from below, it will be 0 or lower, and constantly the value, final value for TI will be 0. And then the output for YI will be 1, right? It will be 0 plus 1. If you look at this for a while, you will see that precisely if at least one of the inputs is 0, then you get, then you get 1 in the output. But if all the inputs are 0, then TI gets the value 1, right? And then the ReLU does not change it, and then YI gives you 0. Which is precisely the definition of a disjunction. Okay? So these are the disjunctions. And finally, we also need conjunctions, right, for the final formula that we have. So this is also pretty simple. So the conjunction, you just take the sum of whatever it is that you're trying to do a conjunction on, and you use so as part of the verification problem, you can also specify the output property. Right? So the property that you will be checking is that the output is precisely n. And so this is how you express the conjunctions. So if we, and this clearly holds only if and only if all the inputs are precisely 1. So when you put all of this together, so if you start from your Boolean formula, you can construct a network just like this. Right? So you start from your variables, you negate them where you need to for your literals, you get your clauses. Right? And in each of them, you do the disjunction trick that we saw. This gives you the yi to yn. These are just the outputs of the disjuncts, of the disjunctions. And then for the conjunction, you do this trick with y. You just sum up all your yi's until you get the final y. Now, the input property that we are checking is for every every xi is either 0 or 1. And the output is precisely n. And so you can rigorously show that this this works, right? You the neural network that you get combined with this property is satisfiable if and only if the original Boolean formula was satisfiable. So there is one thing that I didn't really go into. So xi is either 0 or 1 is not a linear constraint, right? I said that we only allow linear constraints. So this is for the sake of the presentation, but it's really easy to express this also as linear constraints. You can have a look at the proof later. Okay, so so now that we know that the problem is NP complete, right? So we expect that it will be hard. And there's this corollary that says that the verification problem remains NP complete also if you allow P and Q to have arbitrary Boolean structure. And this is why I wanted to show you the construction, because you can very Spoiler alert. So it's easy to handle arbitrary Boolean structure by adding these additional disjunctions and negations, right? So you can just do it the same way that we used it in the construction. And so it's enough to solve the verification problem just for conjunctions, right? So this is why we're just focusing on conjunctions of constraints in P and Q. Because really you can express other things also if you wanted to. And also we focused just on the ReLU activation function, but you can really use it for other things as well, right? So ReLU is a piecewise linear function. Max pooling is also piecewise linear. You can also express max pooling. So you can also express, so max pooling and ReLU are really interchangeable. It's very easy to express one in terms of the other. So ReLU of X is by definition the max between X and zero, right? So clearly you can do this using a max pool operator. And max you can also express using ReLUs, right? So if you want the max between x and y, you can just compute the ReLU of x minus y plus y. So if x is greater than y, then x minus y is positive. So ReLU of x minus y is x minus y, and then the y cancels out. But if y is greater than x, then the ReLU gives you zero, and then you just are left with a y. So in other words, it's also enough to just look at networks that have ReLUs, if you care about these piecewise linear activation functions. And the question of how to handle other non-piecewise linear functions is a different question. I will talk a little bit about that also. Okay, so let's have a short summary. So what we've seen so far, the problem of neural network verification is hard, right? It's hard in theory. We know that it's NP-complete. And it's also very hard. So it's NP-complete in the size of the network intuitively, and networks can be quite large. So what can we do, right? We want to solve the problem in practice. So what we will do next is we will see what kind of techniques people have been using to overcome this problem in the real world, right? So it's often the case in verification that the problems are very difficult theoretically, but in practice you can often solve them for real systems. So I will tell you what people have been up to. Then afterwards we will go into more detail about one of these techniques. Yeah, okay. So the question is basically where does the hardness come from, right? If it comes from these ReLU activation functions, can we get rid of the hardness by getting rid of the ReLU functions? So the most extreme case that you could have is don't have activation functions at all, right? Then the network is just a big linear transformation, then it's super easy to check, but it also doesn't do anything interesting. Machine learning people will not be able to train it to do interesting stuff. So far, verification has focused mostly on these ReLUs, which are really the easiest, the simplest activation function out there that I know of. And we see that even for ReLUs, the problem is already complicated. Likewise, for max pooling. And for the non-piecewise linear activation functions, I'm not sure if there's a hardness result. But my intuition is that it's even harder than the piecewise linear. Yeah. So this is a matter of intuition. So some of the state-of-the-art techniques that I will mention try to attack also the sigmoids, and you will see, I'm not sure that it is easier. Yeah. Maybe I'm wrong. Yeah?
Maybe more of a comment than a question. I think, like, regarding this question, this it has to be inherently hard since, I mean, any sensible neural network or the task of neural networks is to approximate something highly nonlinear. So if you have anything that can approximate nonlinear functions arbitrarily close, like, it has to be complex in and of itself.
Yeah. Yeah, so the comment is about that we need non-piecewise, non-linear elements in our neural network in order for it to do its job, and yeah, intuitively this is where the difficulty is then coming from. Okay? Okay, so what have people been up to, right? So first a disclaimer, the literature on this field is changing very, very quickly. I saw another paper when I was on the plane on the way here, and I didn't have time now to add any of the slides. So I'm going to mention some of the work that I'm aware of. Don't be upset if I forgot yours. Okay. So I'm classifying the techniques roughly into a few categories, just so it's easier to present. So the main difficulty in verification is always scalability. This is always the case. And people have been trying two things in this regard. So first, one class of techniques are the sound and complete techniques. So these are techniques that afford limited scalability. Scalability is a real issue for these techniques. But sound and complete means that they always succeed. Right? So sound means that their answer is always correct, and complete means that they will always give you an answer. Right? So if you combine these two things, you will get an answer, a correct answer for every question that you give them. Another kind of techniques that people have been using are the sound and incomplete techniques. Right? So here you get correct answers, but you may not get an answer. And this gives you better scalability, but sometimes the technique will not be able to prove what you've asked it to prove. And so this is really a spectrum, right? Sometimes you need to trade something to get better scalability, and people have been looking at all kinds of different approaches. And then somewhat orthogonally to these, you have abstraction techniques, which is another thing that I'm going to mention. These can be either sound and complete or sound and incomplete. They sort of can be mixed with other techniques also. And there are many other related techniques that I will not be talking about, like testing of neural networks, there are coverage criteria, concolic testing. These can also be regarded as some sort of verification that's even further down the spectrum, right? Where you traded even more things for better scalability, but this is really beyond my scope today. So the usual question that I get when I say that scalability is the issue is, well, how big a network can you verify? Right, so I'm going to answer this right now by saying that it's very difficult to answer this question, right? Because comparing different approaches and different networks is very difficult. So some of the causes for this difficulty are first, it turns out that the properties that you're testing really make a difference. Right, so you can take the same network, maybe the AKSXU networks, and you can test one property and then another property, and one will finish very quickly and another may not finish at all. Right, so it's not just the size of the network, it's also the property that you're checking. Then people often try to compare techniques that are complete with those that are incomplete. Right? So these kind of techniques, I mean, it's useful to know which perform on larger networks, but they're really solving a different question. Right? So you also need to take that into account. When you ask how big is the network that you can verify, you need to really say what kind of verification you mean. Also, I mean, we want to compare approaches and algorithms, and sometimes we end up comparing implementations, which is, again, is very useful to know which implementations are better than others, but this is also something that you need to consider when you compare approaches. And finally, people are really using different benchmarks, right? So not all networks of the same size are of the same difficulty. So in this regard, there's actually been one paper from a PhD student here at Oxford that try to take several of these approaches and do a comparison, like translate the benchmarks between one approach and the other. And this, I think if this trend will continue, then we will know a little better how to compare different approaches. So this will be very nice. But still, right, if I need to answer this question, then right now the state of the art, as far as I'm aware in general, is that the complete techniques can typically handle networks that have a few hundred to a few thousand nodes. Whereas the incomplete techniques can do an order of magnitude better and handle networks that have thousands to tens of thousands of nodes. So this is, again, a rule of thumb. There are cases where you can maybe do better, but this is a fast-growing field. Right? So there's a lot of work here, and I'm optimistic that this will improve over the next few years. Okay, so now let's talk concretely about some of these techniques. So one of the first papers that appeared was about a tool called Never by Pulina and Tacella. It appeared at CAV 2010. And this was really one of the first attempts to verify neural networks. And they actually focused on networks with sigmoids, right? So not on piecewise linear activation functions. And their main idea was to do an over-approximation of the sigmoids in order to simplify them and then apply interval arithmetic. Okay, so what is an over-approximation? So quick introduction. So it's a very common theme in verification. And the core idea is to take a system that is very difficult for us to verify, some system S, and replace it with a simpler system, S bar. And you construct this S bar in a way that guarantees that all of the behaviors of S also appear in S bar. You may have, however, some additional spurious behaviors in S bar which do not exist in the original, but because this S bar is simpler, it's also easier to verify. Okay, so graphically, it looks something like this. So we suppose you have some system S, right, and it has the shape of a circle, and you don't know how to verify circles. Circles are very, very difficult for you to verify. Then you create some other system, S bar, that has another shape, it's a square, right? And suppose squares you do know how to verify, and you construct S bar in a way that contains all the behaviors of S. Right? So S is contained in S bar. If you are able to show that S bar is correct, then so is S, right? Because every behavior of S also appears in S bar, and all of these behaviors are okay. But if you get that S bar is incorrect, then you're not sure, right? It can mean that S is also incorrect. So this will happen if the counterexample that you found is in the intersection between S and S bar, right? Like this red dot. But it could also be the case that the bad behavior that you detected is spurious, as in the case of this green dot, right? It's a behavior of S bar, but not a behavior of S. And so this is an over-approximation. And what people often do is that if they encounter this green dot scenario, then they refine S bar, right? They change its shape to exclude the spurious counterexample that they found. So this is over-approximation in general, and Pulina and Tacella applied this to neural networks. And what they did, so this is all the figures in this part of the slides are from the papers that are cited. So here they took this sigmoid activation function, which is this S-shaped thing, and they tried to approximate it using a piecewise linear approximation. So what they did was they just split the range, the X range, into small intervals, and for each of these intervals, they just said that the output is somewhere in another interval. Right, so for example, if X is in the range between XA and XB that's marked there, then they just assume that the output is somewhere on the vertical interval. Right, so it's a way to abstract this S-shaped function into a piecewise linear thing. And then they just fed the abstraction that they got into a solver that knows how to handle interval arithmetic. And if they got a spurious counterexample, then they made the X segments smaller. Right? This refines the abstraction and makes it closer to the behavior of the sigmoid function. And this was a very useful first step, but they could only tackle very small networks. Right? So only networks with about 10 neurons, which is a little too small to be of much practical use. But still, this was an interesting first step. Then there were actually a few quiet years. So this was in 2010. Right? Then these guys had another paper, I think, 2 years after that was along the same lines. And then there wasn't much activity until 2016, where Bastani and co-authors had a paper at NIPS where they proposed a technique for evaluating a neural network's adversarial robustness. And so this is where people started caring about adversarial robustness. So there was a lot of work. And this was actually not a paper about verification. They just wanted to evaluate a network's adversarial robustness. And the way they did this was solve a verification-like problem by reducing it to linear programming. So they did not study verification. I think the word verification does not even appear in the paper. But this was interesting applications for verification, so I'm mentioning this paper also. So what is linear programming, this thing that they reduced to? So a linear program, for those who are not familiar, is just a bunch of linear constraints. So you have these x variables. You have a set of equations, linear equations involving these x variables. That's ax equals b. And so this is just a set of equations. Each variable also has lower and upper bounds. These are the l's and the u's. Right? So each of your variables has a range. And finally, you also have some objective function that you want to optimize, for example, minimize. Right? So you're looking at all the x's that solve the equations and the bounds. You want to find the minimal x's such that c times x is the smallest. And this problem occurs in many situations in computer science. It's been studied for several decades now. So it's a very, very common thing. And the problem itself is known to be in P, and pretty powerful solvers exist. So Jan actually mentioned that these solvers are not sufficiently powerful for solving graphs that you get from Markov decision processes, right? But for many neural networks, they are strong enough. So what did these guys do? So they said, okay, we know that we have the neural network and it has these piecewise linear constraints, right? These ReLUs. And each ReLU only has two phases. Either it's active or it's inactive. But each of these phases is really just a linear constraint, right? If you know that the ReLU is active, then you're saying X equals Y and X is greater than zero. Both of these things are linear. If you say that the ReLU is inactive, then you say that X is non-positive and Y is equal to zero. So also linear. So each of these things is a linear constraint. And this is true for all piecewise linear functions, not just for ReLUs, right? You have just a bunch of linear segments. Each of them is a linear constraint. And if you know that a ReLU is in a specific phase, then you can just discard it and replace it with the linear equation. So what these guys did was they took a particular X0, a particular panda, and they ran it through the network. And the network itself, they encoded the weighted sums as linear equations. This is pretty straightforward, and we will see it in a few slides. Then they evaluated the network for X0. And for each ReLU, for this particular X0, they looked and they checked whether it was active or not. So if the ReLU was active for X0, they replaced it with the linear constraint for an active ReLU. If it was inactive for X0, they replaced it with the inactive constraint. Right, so in a way, they took the neural network and they reduced it into a completely linear problem around X0. Right? They just evaluated the ReLUs for X0 and replaced each ReLU with the linear equation that held for that particular ReLU. And then the problem became completely linear. Right? They eliminated all the piecewise linear functions, all the cause of the difficulty. And then the LP solver would just solve the problem that you get. Right? And they would solve it very quickly. And they evaluated this technique on an image recognition network, and they were pretty successful in finding interesting adversarial examples. Right, so this technique was efficient, but this is the first example of a technique that is sound but incomplete. Right, so if you find an adversarial example, then that adversarial example is correct. But it is quite possible that you missed a lot of adversarial inputs because there were points nearby for which you needed to check the other phase of the ReLU. Right, so suppose maybe one particular ReLU was almost zero. It was 0.001. Right? And in order to find the adversarial example, you needed to make it zero completely. But once you eliminated the ReLU and fixed it in the active phase, you lost all this information. Right? So if they say that there is no adversarial example, then they may be wrong. There may still be an adversarial example that was missed. Right? So this is an example of a sound and incomplete technique. But this technique, again, was not given as a verification technique, but rather just as a technique for finding adversarial examples. Okay, so why did I mention this? Because this had an interesting, you could extend this approach to really do verification, right? So there's a very simple way to do a complete extension of this technique. And this is by case splitting. Right, so just enumerate all the possible phases of the ReLUs. For each ReLU, you start by guessing whether it's going to be active or inactive. You get an LP, right? You get a purely linear problem, you solve it. If you find a solution, then you say that the problem is sat. Right, because the solution that you found is valid for the ReLUs in the phases that you guessed, which is fine. But if you get an unsat, if there is no solution for your particular guess, then you backtrack and you try another guess. Right, so it's an exhaustive search, it's pretty straightforward, and only if all the guesses are exhausted, then you say unsat. Right, you checked all possible combinations, and for each of them you couldn't find a solution, then you know that there really is no solution. And this is really very similar to the naive algorithm that you would use for Boolean satisfiability. Right? You would just enumerate all the true-false cases and go over all of them. So case splitting just creates a search tree. Right? And the problem is sat if at least one leaf is sat. Right? So suppose you have a problem that only has two ReLU constraints. Y1 equals ReLU of X1 and Y2 equals ReLU of X2. So you have a search tree. At the first layer, the root of the search tree, you still have both your ReLU constraints. Right? Then in the first layer, you make a guess for the first ReLU. If you want to guess that that ReLU is going to be active, then you remove it, and you replace it with Y1 equals X1, and X1 is greater than zero. Right? So this is your right branch. If you want to guess that it's inactive, you go left. Then in the nodes that are on the first layer, that are marked one, you have one ReLU left. Right? You still have Y2 equals ReLU of X2. So now you guess for that ReLU also. You either guess active by going right or inactive by going left. And then in the leaves, you no longer have any ReLU constraints. You've eliminated all of them. You just have a linear problem, which you can solve using a linear solver. If you get at least one leaf that is green, that is sat, then you know that the original problem is sat, right, as in this case. Okay? Okay, so this approach is sound and complete. If you just explore the entire tree, you get a sound and complete approach. And this approach, so it's been observed that such approaches are very, very sensitive to the heuristics and the tricks that you use for trimming the search space. Right, so by heuristics, I mean, for example, you can pick the order of variables that you split on. Also, you can find tricks to allow you to trim, like to figure out that you don't need to search on certain parts of the tree. Right? And all of these things will really boost the performance of your approach. This is also very well known for Boolean satisfiability, and the same happened here. And there's been a sequence of papers that extended this basic approach of the k-splitting algorithm with various heuristics. So there was a paper by Radiger Ehlers in 2017, a solver called the Planet Solver, where, again, the basic idea was this k-splitting algorithm, but he added this nice extension where you do little sub-searches and you try to find tight bounds on certain variables using these little extra searches, and this allowed you to trim your search tree by figuring out that some variables had to be active or inactive. Was another paper by Cheng and Drake. Another one by Rudy Bunnell, which I already mentioned, that's the paper that did a comparison between various solvers. So they also had a solver of their own that had an interesting splitting heuristic, which they showed, like the order of splits that you do. And they showed that this was also quite useful. Another one by Lumush, Yu, and Manjanti. And even yet another newer one from a group of people at SRI that introduced the Sherlock solver, where you incorporate these little local search steps into your global k-splitting algorithm. So what I want to show here that there is a lot of work on improving the heuristics for these sound and complete approaches that I hope will get some improvement in scalability over the few coming years. Okay, so now I'll talk about some of the other approaches. So there was another paper at CAV last year by Huang and his co-authors where they proposed an approach called DLV. So here they wanted, so their set of mind was, a neural network is too large. We cannot explore, because the problem is difficult, we cannot explore all the possibilities. So let's just concentrate on some sort of discretization of the input space. All right, so they introduced the concept of a manipulation. So they say, basically, we look at a particular input point, and we allow it to be changed only in certain ways. And this can represent maybe camera scratches, rotations, etc. Right? So this also reminds me of the question that we had before about how you can restrict yourself to certain interesting inputs. So this is what they try to do. And this is a sound and incomplete approach. Right? So it's a little hard to see, but you start from some point that's in the middle of this picture. And then each arrow is just one manipulation that you can do. Right? It's one alteration that you are allowed to do to your input space. And then you have like the space that you care about is this rectangle, and you just enumerate over all the manipulations that you can do, and you check correctness in all of these. And they add this approach that does an exhaustive search in a layer-by-layer way. So you do every layer of the network individually. So this is clearly sound and incomplete, right? If you find a counterexample, then that counterexample is correct. But if you say that there is no counterexample, right, if you fail to find the adversarial example, then it doesn't mean that such an adversarial example does not exist. But they could scale to larger networks. Right? So they had they released their tool called the DLV solver, which is available online. Then there was a very interesting paper earlier this year by Ger et al, where they did an over-approximation of the input property. So this was a nice trick. And the idea was intuitively something like this. So you start with your input property, right? So here you only have 4 points that you care about, right? So these are the 4 points that you see on the left. And they do an over approximation of these points using some sort of shape, right? Some sort of polyhedra. And then they know how to propagate these polyhedra through the network. So you see the different colors represent different polyhedra that you can use, and you see their output on the right. So this is what the shape looks like when you feed it through the network. And then this is again an over-approximation scheme, same as we talked before. So you just see if the shape that you got on the right satisfies your property. Right? So you see if any of the outputs that are in the shape that you got are bad outputs. If all the outputs are good, then you say that your property holds. And if not, you need to do some refinement step. You need to change the shape that you use. So also sound and incomplete. Right? They can find They can, so here it's soundness of a different kind. They can prove that the property holds, but if it doesn't hold, it doesn't mean that it doesn't hold in the original, right? Because you could have a spurious counterexample. There could be a point, say, in the rectangle on the right that is violating your property, but it is not one of the original points that you cared about. So also sound and incomplete. Okay, and then the last kind of these approaches that I wanted to mention is where you treat the network as a continuous function. Right, so a network you can just regard it as a continuous function from the inputs to the outputs, right? And verification is just means analyzing the output, the properties of this function. And often you can even reduce these properties to a single output that you care about, in which case you only have to analyze a real valued function. And so this is even simpler than analyzing a multi-valued function. And typically what you want to do is to find lower and upper bounds on your output. So here there was a recent paper by Juan et al. So they focused on something called the Lipschitz continuity. So this is a concept that says it basically measures by how much a function shrinks its inputs. Right? So you have the distance between x1 and x2, which are the inputs, is proportional to the distance between f of x1 and f of x2, which is the outputs, according to some constant k. Right? So k is called the Lipschitz constant. And the smaller the k, the better. Right? You want to find the tightest k that you can, because this really characterizes the behavior of the network tightly. So what they did, what these guys did, was they wanted to partition the input space and bound the output of each piece using this Lipschitz constant, and took something like this. So this the blue line is the output of the network, and this this interval between yk minus 1 to yk is the interval that they look at. And they put some upper bound and lower bound on the network, on its output, using the Lipschitz constant, right? So these k diagonal lines are the Lipschitz they are affected by the Lipschitz constant that you have. And then this gives you some bounds on the network's output. And if these bounds are enough to show the property that you're after, then you can stop. And if not, you do some refinement step. You split the region into smaller parts, and you work on each of these individually. So suppose the property holds for k equals 10, right? If you assign k to 10, then this will hold. You can also, it will also be true for larger k's, right? You can pick k that is 1,000. It will also be true, right? You can increase k as much as you want. So if you find the smallest k, then you get more information, right? You can do more. So it's more useful to have the smallest k that you can. And in particular, for this approach, it's also useful. But I mean, okay, so like I said, they had this tool called DeepGo. They iteratively refined the partition of the input space until the bounds are sufficiently accurate. And they also gave a proof that this converges, right? So if you do it enough times, eventually you will get an answer. And if you have a smaller value of k, right, then the convergence will come faster. And you just terminate when you discover that the input bounds, that bounds apply the property that you're after. And so this is a sound and complete approach. So we know that it is NP-complete. The problem is NP-complete in the size of the network. But the complexity of this particular approach also depends on the size of the input domain, right? Because you are splitting the input domain into pieces. Yes?
But do we know how to compute the Lipschitz constant?
So the question is, how do you compute the Lipschitz constant? So here there are some papers on that that are coming from the machine learning community. They know how to take the weights of the network and do some approximation of the Lipschitz constant. I don't think they can find efficiently the best one, but they can give you some approximation. Okay, and now a very quick enumeration of all the things that I'm not going to talk about. So there's been some work on verifying binarized neural networks. So this is where people, so this is a concept that exists in the machine learning community where you want a network that is simplified. And you simplify it by giving up some of your precision in the weights, right? You switch to binary weights, and then your weights become smaller, but your network becomes a little less precise. And there's the question of how do you verify these networks. So people have been studying that as well. So I mentioned verification using LP solvers. There's also another set of tools called quadratic solvers that people have also been using for verification. There's another approach on reachability using over approximations. So there's all of these. Again, there's so many papers that it's very difficult to talk about each of them very thoroughly. So there's also some work. So when you talk about adversarial robustness, you care about what kind of norm you use. So most papers focus on L infinity, L1 or L2 norms, but there's also some work on L0 norms. So there's been even a paper on verifying those. And many people are working on improving scalability using parallelization. Right? So you can do this by partitioning the input space, like we saw, and there are also other approaches. There's even more Lipschitz-based approaches, including a very early paper that I stumbled upon from 2002, where people already tried to use Lipschitz-based approaches to verify neural networks, but they had very limited scalability. And finally, there's a whole line of work on training safe networks. And so people say, okay, instead of getting a network and then checking that it does what we want, let's incorporate the objective that we want into the training process and get a network that is correct by construction. So this is like the synthesis version of neural network verification. And there's a few papers here also, including a nice line of work from Google DeepMind. So they're looking into that. Okay, so to conclude what you've seen so far, so neural network verification is hard, right? It's NP-complete even for simple networks and simple properties. It's reducible to an exponential sequence of easy problems, these linear programs that we know how to solve efficiently, but there's too many of them so that we can do this efficiently. And this approach is sound and complete. And people have been working on finding efficient heuristics for improving the scalability here. And if you want, you can also trade completeness for better scalability, which is the sound and incomplete approaches that we saw. And these can even be combined with abstraction techniques. So coming up next, I will talk about one of the sound and complete techniques called ReluPlex, which is a project that I was and still am involved in. Okay, so that's a good question. So the question is, how do you know that X should be a panda in order to check that it is that it and its neighbors are classified as a panda? So nobody has a good answer for that. I will talk about that a little bit in the next part of the presentation. But intuitively, it's very problematic. So we call this the cat recognition network, right? If you have a network that is supposed to recognize cats, you don't know how to specify what cats are, so you don't know how to check that it does what it should. So one of the challenges in verification is to get properties to verify, right? To know what you need to verify. So what people have been doing for adversarial robustness is that they typically evaluate it on points that they already know what they should be. So for example, you start with your input points and you know how these should be classified and you check that they are classified correctly. There are some variants where you can do this without having a lot of information on your input. I will briefly mention those, but this is still an open problem in general. On the other hand, you have cases like the AKAS-XU networks where the person who created the network knows what the network should do and they know how to define it more formally, and these are easier to verify. But in general, in verification, it's difficult to get programmers or clients in this case to give you the properties that you need. Okay, so the question is checking for adversarial robustness better than testing, really? So if you check for a finite set of points, then choosing the points is like testing, right? You need to choose the five pandas that you're checking. But for each of these pandas, you will do a verification pass, right? So you will verify that there are no adversarial inputs near that panda. So this is stronger than testing. Maybe you want to, it's an interesting open question. How do you take a finite set of points, evaluate the robustness, and from this understand something about the robustness of the network as a whole? I will talk a little bit about that, but in general, it's an open question. Okay, so I can't repeat the question because there were too many numbers, but... The question is, so for modern networks like the Cypher-10 network, they are pretty large, and so verifying them is a problem, right? Scalability is the main issue in verification in general and in neural networks. Some of the papers that I mentioned were able to check some properties on networks that I think, I'm not sure if it was this particular one, but they had, they were larger than the AKAS-XU networks that I mentioned. They had maybe a few hundred thousands, I think, maybe. This is the main challenge that we are dealing with. No, but people have been working for a very short while, and hopefully in a few years we will be closer to that goal. So the question is, do adversarial examples come from the input, from the test, from the training set, or are there other points? So you can do an evaluation on any point that you like, right? You can pick any point in the input space and look for adversarial robustness, for adversarial inputs around that point. But what people normally do is they pick points from their training set because they already know how these points should be classified, right? So like if you take a picture, if you take a point that is clearly a panda, right? It's very, very clearly should be a panda, then you expect adversarial robustness around that point. If you pick a point, say, at random, then maybe, so there's a natural border between a panda and a cat, right? There's some image that's directly between a panda and a cat, and it can go either way. There has to be some image like that. So if you wanted to evaluate the robustness of that particular image, then maybe the results will not be interesting, right? Because, so that is, I think, why people are focusing on images that they already know how they should be classified, like, very strongly. The question is, are the points that we trained on more robust than other points? I'm actually not sure. That's an interesting question. You will have, no matter the network, eventually you will reach some boundary between the two labels, and for those points you expect low robustness, and that's fine. Right? That's just the normal behavior of the network. What is considered bad behavior is networks, is points that are deep within one region, one label, and still there exist adversarial inputs that are nearby. Okay, so the question is really, what do you do when you have a counterexample, right? If you found something bad through your verification process, what do you do? So the obvious thing that you can do is just take this point and add it to the training set and retrain your network. Right, then you will have a network that solves the particular problem that you found. A more general question is this particular input that you found indicative of some larger problem that you are not aware of, and how do you generalize this? This is not particularly a verification-related question. Right? This is a neural network or training question, and I'm probably not the best person to answer. Yeah, so the question is, can you use verification to synthesize input points that have very high confidence? The answer is yes. And everything that you can express as a linear constraint on the outputs, you can cast as a verification question. Right, so you would just say that output number 10 is greater than, I don't know, 0.9, whatever, and you could find points like that. Yeah, so I won't be talking about that even in the, well, maybe a bit, but I will just say a few words now. So the question is about parallelization and how can we use it. So there are basically two things that you can parallelize. First, if you have a large input domain and you want to prove that a certain property holds for that entire domain, you can just split the domain up into pieces and verify each of them independently. And I think at least one of the papers that I enumerated does that. I don't remember which. Another thing that you could do is parallelize the actual verification algorithm. This is a more difficult task. It's known to be very difficult to do those things for various solvers. But this is an open research question. So the question is, why are neural networks susceptible to, like, why does the noise fool them? I know that there's a lot of research in machine learning about figuring out why this is happening. I don't think that there is a conclusive answer yet. And to that question, I'm definitely not the correct person to give an answer. So the question is about what's called recurrent networks, where you have some sort of feedback loop that goes from the output back into the input. So this is, as far as I know, nobody has tackled this question yet. It's an interesting problem. So if you look at traditional verification, so this would be the equivalent of loops, right? Which are a known issue in traditional verification. And what you do there is either you do an unwinding of the loop for a finite number of steps, and then you just check that the behavior is correct for, say, 3, 4, 10 steps. This you could probably do using the existing techniques. Another thing that people do is they use invariants. Right? I think Jan also talked about that a bit. So you could, in theory, have the equivalent also for neural networks. Right? You would guess an invariant, prove that it holds, that it's an inductive invariant, and then use it to prove your property. But as far as I know, nobody has done that yet. So good research direction. So the question is, do the various verification approaches put some restrictions on the topology of the neural network? As far as I remember, no. So people don't really care about, I don't think that this is a restriction. So the question is, is it allowed that, say, some edges will be missing from the neural network, or that a certain neuron will be connected to several other layers? These are typically cases that occur in convolutional neural networks, and these are supported, so that should be fine. So I think that is supported by, well, I'm not sure if by all approaches, but at least by some. Definitely supported by the ReLUplex approach that I will talk about next.